Let me hand over to our moderator for this panel, Mr. Fabio Veras. He is currently the Communications, Publication and Research Coordinator of the IPC-IG. And he will introduce our guests and guide us through that expert panel. Fabio, over to you.
So the objective of the panel is actually to discuss how to sustain the social protection response that have emerged during the crisis or is still emerging during the crisis in the long term. The second objective is actually how to ensure equitable access to comprehensive risk coverage for the entire population through a coherent system in the future. So basically we're talking about how to ensure that in the future, we are going to have a universal social protection. What we are not defining here, it's up to the speakers that are going to discuss with us to define, is what we mean by universal social protection and how to get there. But we are talking about a conference that has looked at the country's response to the COVID-19. So basically the idea is that we look at this response and try to see how this response came from the actions that are going to be taken in the future by the countries and that are going to be supported by all of us, the practitioners and the policymakers that work in the area of social protection. So to help us to reflect on these two key questions, we are going to listen to Shahrashoub. She's the director of Social Protection Department of the International Labour Organization. Natalia Winder Rossi from UNICEF. She's the associate director, the global chief of social policy. Michal Rutkowski is the global, he's the global director for social protection and jobs at the World Bank. Rachel Moussier, she's the deputy director of the social protection program at the Women in Informal Employment, Globalizing and Organizing. So we have the civil society voice here. And to complete our panel, we have Juan Miguel Villa. He's the president of Colpensiones, who is the state enterprise responsible for pensions in Colombia. In Colombia, as you know, was one of the stars of the conference. We had Colombia actually exposing the experience in two panels. So we also have it in the final panel here. The next slide, please. So we saw that the conference had two guiding questions covering how to better understand social protection response to the COVID-19. So in the beginning of the final day today, we had Valentina, we had Martina taking us to have a look of what has been discussed and look at the different dimensions and how these eight questions have been dealt with by the different response of the countries globally. So here, basically, we are moving a little bit from the shock responsiveness and what the countries have done, and we're trying to think on how to actually strengthen the existing social protection system in the country. So we are actually trying to reduce a little bit these eight questions to three basic questions. We are going to look at the coverage, we're going to look at the comprehensiveness of the system, and the adequacy of the system. For that, we have prepared three questions for the panelists, but we also want to hear from the audience. So we ask the audience to put their questions on the poll, on the Slido, sorry. And and we'd also like to hear from you or your opinion about which one of these dimensions are most important or should be prioritized in order to force the social protection system in the long run. Also to recall here that we shouldn't forget SDG target 1.3.1, which is basically to increase social protection coverage, including social protection floors for all in a significant manner, particularly for the poor and vulnerable by 2030. So what have we learned for the COVID-19 that could inform us on how to expand that, how to cover the missing middle, how to address risks and contingencies that are not covered in some countries? How can international organizations support that? How can we finance it? So these are some of the questions that we would like to hear from our panelists, but also from you. So please, now we are going to have two polls to see a little bit of your views in terms of the priority, what you think that COVID-19 has actually caused, whether it can be something that can change the course of the social protection options. So we can go for the first poll please. So the first question you're going to see on the screen. So which scenario will be most realistically for your country or the country or the countries you work in terms of catalyzing universal social protection after the COVID-19 crisis? So we're going there. Are we optimistic? We are neutral. We're not pessimistic. Okay, it seems we are either optimistic or neutral. Should I vote as well? No, I cannot vote. So when we get to 80, should we stop? No, it's still running. It's still okay. I see the countdown. So if we are optimistic, so we think that some of these measures that having been adopted by the countries can actually have a long-lasting effects. Perhaps they are going to be transformed in something that's going to be more permanent. So I think that the majority among us believe that that will happen. But still some of us are a little bit skeptical. We maybe go back to where we were before. We may have issues with financing, how to sustain the financing for social protection when we're not in an emergency, when countries do not increase the expenditure, they are not willing to change the budget, or they don't have macroeconomic conditions to increase the level of debt or to convince their IFIs to do so. So we are done. So we are still optimistic, 51% of us, and 32% are neutral. So you think that it doesn't going to have a major effect on universal social protection, and a minority, 17%, are skeptical. So let's go to the second question of the poll that basically asks you which dimension do you think it's more important in terms to achieve universal social protection? Would you invest more in coverage, so expanding social protection? Are you going to invest more on adequacy, increasing existing benefits, or creating new benefits and having it in a way that probably coverage will be more challenging? We had a little bit of this discussion in the former panel. Claire was discussing that, the trade-offs between increasing coverage and increasing adequacy. Or we may look at the comprehensiveness. Perhaps what the COVID-19 crisis actually showed us is that we do need to have, for example, unemployment benefits. The majority of low middle income countries and even low income countries do not have unemployment benefits, for example. Some countries have created temporary unemployment benefits as a result of the crisis. Would that lead them to actually have unemployment insurance and employment benefits as a policy to follow to achieve universal social protection? So if you think that that's the biggest lesson, then we should go for the comprehensiveness. So we are done. So the priority here is coverage. And actually we start our panel with the discussion around coverage. So each one of the panelists, you are going to have 3 minutes to address a simple question. So what are the possible ways to permanently, and not just as a crisis response, short-term, temporary, extend social protection to those that are not yet covered? So I pass the first one. It's gonna be Shara from ILO. Shara, can you address this question, please? The floor is yours.
Okay, thank you, Fabio. That's coming after all the magic. It's gonna be a bit difficult. I'm just going to start by saying that I think, you know, there have been many labels for the COVID crisis, but to me, I think the label of the great revealer is a very good one. It has revealed so many gaps and problems that we've had in our social protection system. And I think one of the big issues that has really come out quite strongly, as you, I think, alluded right now, is as we've seen the kind of devastation that has happened in terms of jobs and with millions of jobs, billions of jobs being lost, was really the fact that for the great majority of workers, you know, 61% of the global workforce that is in the informal economy, there was really very little to fall back on. So they were couldn't really count on a contributory social security system, and they were not well served by very narrowly targeted cash transfers. So that really, I think that was the story of the missing middle. But in order to do something about that, we need to first agree that that something should be done about sort of workers in the informal economy. Now, international human rights standards, I think, are very clear that all persons, regardless of what kind of employment they have, what duration of employment, they should enjoy the right to social security. But I think for a long time, we've had a very contradictory messages coming from the international financial institutions who've been promoting labor market deregulation and kind of seeing informalization as something that we just have to live with, you know, while putting the emphasis on developing very narrowly targeted sort of measures that capture the poor to be sort of efficient. And I think COVID has shown the limitations of that. And we have a lot of, you know, we have evidence in terms of how social protection can be extended to informal workers. Of course, when we talk about workers in the informal economy, it's a very diverse group. You know, if we're talking about 61% of the global workforce, obviously there are huge differences. There are wage workers, there are others who are informally self-employed, own account workers, or contributing family workers. And the challenges of extending coverage to them, particularly through contributory systems, become particularly difficult when there are no employers. And that's the case, you know, no obvious employer in the case of, for example, self-employed own account workers. But there we have good practices that we can, you know, cite from different countries. And we've done that in the ILO in a very nice handbook that my colleague Christina Berendt has put together on showing the extension of social protection to informal workers, particularly self-employed workers. And here we see that there are ways of doing it. There's sort of, for example, simplifying social contribution and tax payment mechanisms, which has been tried in several Latin American countries, Argentina, Brazil, Uruguay. It's called the mono tax, which really makes it easy for small micro enterprises and self-employed people to pay a single, have a single flat payment instead of making different contributions, social security and tax contributions. Or you have adaptations of contributions, lowering the contribution level, or for some workers and some people not requiring any contribution at all, subsidizing, with the government subsidizing their contributions, for example, to social health insurance, as in the case of Ghana or the rural pension scheme in Brazil. And there are also some lessons that I think we need to learn here. One is that voluntary coverage doesn't lead to a significant extension of effective coverage or, you know, create a big risk pool, which is what you need, because it could create adverse selection. So you need to really make coverage mandatory. That's really important. Then also, we know that having specific schemes for informal workers that are separate from those of formal workers can also be very problematic, because it can create disincentives for people to formalize or even create incentives for informalization, and also reduce portability and shifting of people between different kinds of work. And also, I think it's very important to make sure that the extension of social protection to workers in the informal economy really has to bring a real value that people can see, that workers can see. And this means systems that are trustworthy, that the public has trust in them, that they're transparent, there's accountability. So I think this combination will really be very useful. And I should also end by saying that, you know, we should also very much as social protection people be thinking about people who are not in the labor force, but who do very valuable other kinds of work. I'm thinking of, you know, unpaid care work, voluntary work, a lot of work that makes our economies tick and really sets the foundation for the economies. We also have to think about very, very robust systems of social protection for people who are not in the labor force and for people who do other kinds, make other kinds of contributions. So I'll stop there.
Okay, thank you, Shara, very much. I pass then to Natalia. Natalia, I think that the end of Shara is a perfect moment for you to step in and perhaps reflect a little bit also on the role of universal child benefits. Thank you.
Thank you, Fabio. Maybe to start to thank socialprotection.org for organizing this very timely event and the invitation to be in this panel. We've been very excited as UNICEF to be part of the sessions, but I think more critically to have to put our heads together in a forward-looking perspective of what do we do now? How do we move forward? I think, as Shara mentioned, this is a pandemic that definitely highlighted a lot of progress and a lot of commendable efforts from many of our governments around effectively responding to the crisis and the prioritization given to social protection. But it also highlighted a lot of gaps in the systems. And one of the ones that you mentioned, of course, in this first question is around coverage. And let me maybe focus on the challenge that we still have in terms of children. As we know, nearly two-thirds of children around the world are not covered by effective social protection. Two-thirds of the world's children population. And this, where before the pandemic, we had around 386 million children living in extreme poverty. And as you know, children are overrepresented when we're talking about poverty and in comparison with other age groups. And now recent estimates that we did together with Save the Children highlight that the economic fallout of the pandemic is threatening to push an additional 117 million children into monetary poverty by the end of this year. And if we go a little bit deeper, the gaps are not just around overall coverage, but also the gaps become even more critical when we look to children living in humanitarian and fragile contexts that are not within any existing or functioning system, or children on the move that despite having equal rights to receive social protection, they're not usually systematically integrated into social protection responses. I'm talking about, of course, migrants, refugees, internally displaced populations, and others which are not at this moment, with some exceptions, included in some of their responses. Children living in ethnic or indigenous communities that are not always effectively reached or counting with adequate responses to respond to particular socioeconomic characteristics. And of course, very much as highlighted by the very interesting gender session that I participated a couple of days ago, we are also having a lot of limitations in terms of our gender-sensitive response, despite our commitments in the Commission of the Status of Women only last year. I think this is the time to continue to strengthen our efforts around a very strong evidence base and investment case on the importance of a progressive move towards universal coverage. And I hope you had the chance to participate in that particular session where we focus on universal child grants, emphasizing not only its importance from a rights perspective, but of course, very critically, the financial case, the pathways around it, the thought about a progressive roadmap. Sometimes when we think about universal approaches, we get a little frightened of what will that mean. But I think it's very clear that we're talking about a progressive approach, looking at different age groups, for instance. And also in linking to the financing case, I think the examples presenting in those sessions were also very illuminating to show that it is a financial as much as a political decision. And many of the countries that right now have some form of universal child grants, where at the moment that they've started to develop these programs have very similar economic stages as many of developing countries today. I think it was very also important to see it from the role that these programs play in terms of social cohesion and enhancing the social contract. So in other words, not only looking at monetary poverty, but also on allowing children and their families to effectively participate in life communities and definitely avoiding to be part of a process of stigmatization. I think that in addition to that, we need to continue to make emphasis that universality does not mean that we do not make explicit efforts to have adequate design to be able to effectively address the specific characteristics of certain groups. For instance, those living in rural areas, indigenous communities, others, but it's definitely a minimum critical first step. And maybe two last points. One is that it's important that we continue to think about a system and not just specific programs and the ability of a systems approach to effectively link different sectoral programs to address the multiple and compounding vulnerabilities that we see across the life cycle from early childhood to older age. And of course, we have a lot of topics to cover, but the importance of looking at critical parts of the system that the that this pandemic made very clear we still need to invest on. And of course, Shara mentioned the informal economy, but within that, I think that the critical importance of having a much more stronger commitment around the care sector and in family-friendly policies that we still need to enhance and effectively enhance its coverage. I'll stop there. Thank you.
Fabio, you're muted.
Okay, sorry, Michal. It's your turn now. On the extension of social protection, the coverage of social protection.
Thank you very much. Good morning, good afternoon, everybody. Pleasure to be here. Thanks very much for the invitation. I think it is important to start indeed with some more precise notion of universalism. I think of universal social protection by analogy to universal health coverage. Everybody who needs social protection gets social protection. So it is distinct from the notion that everybody at every point in time has social protection. There are many people who don't need it. The COVID crisis is a game changer when it comes to social protection indeed. And what we see is enormous reaction of policymakers. Over 200 countries and territories have introduced, adapted or planned more than 1,000 measures. And we see that cash transfers were scaled up by 217% and doubled in amount. And this is not accidental, because the expansion is actually a result of deliberate, systematic and cumulative process of generating evidence, knowledge and practices over time. That response in part is a temporary response and is meant to be temporary. So I think we need to qualify a bit a phrase used at the beginning, a sustained response. We want to enhance social protection, made it more universal, always starting with the most poor and vulnerable. So we use the notion of progressive universalism, but it is not necessarily means that those who were covered in the COVID crisis are those who are our priorities to be covered in the long run. Having said that, the COVID crisis exposed what Shara talked about, the missing middle problem, that urban informal sector are the most unprotected part of the labor force. And certainly it is very important to go towards covering them. Now, what are the main lessons for universal social protection coming from the COVID crisis? I think the first lesson is that we need social protection systems that are adaptive, that can flex and respond to needs in a timely fashion. So that really prompted us to think harder about the way we not only respond, but also prepare for future crises. Here, really the core is a strong delivery systems, the registries, people financially included, being properly identified, being able to be reached through modern digital means. This is all a foundation of ability for systems to scale up when needed and scale down when needed. Already before COVID crisis, we knew that both the severity of shocks and the number of shocks has been steadily growing for the last 40, 50 years. COVID only adds to that, it underlies, it almost symbolizes this. So the need for systems that can scale up and scale down quickly, which are dynamic and adaptive, is absolutely critical, and they need to be based on a strong delivery basis. The second important element is connecting cash transfers to recovery and resilience building activities. So the possibility of expanding social safety nets to urban informal sector is the right direction. But, and here I like the term used in this conference, the increased comprehensiveness. Yes, we need to equip everybody with the capacity to deal with all kinds of risk. So expanding social insurance to the poorest and most vulnerable and to rural as well as urban areas is definitely a priority. And we do have We do have apologies for that call, which will continue for a while. With this, I think what is critical is to think in modern ways of how social insurance could be expanded to urban areas. It's not a simple expansion of existing systems, because existing systems are too rigid and too old-fashioned to do it. It needs to be done in the modern way, using incentives, using behavioral nudging, in order to have people on a voluntary basis contributing to social insurance systems. Finally, I wanted to say that the COVID crisis and the exposure of the missing middle is for us also a big wake-up call to think of the financing of social protection. Other than social safety net, too much, for a long time we identified social insurance with payroll taxes, with big harm to workers and their families. And I think it is very important at times when the payroll is 10% of Kenyan economy and mobile money transactions are observable in 80% of the population, to think of the broadest possible tax base as being a foundation of the expansion of social protection systems. Otherwise, we will be in the old world of complaining that the economy is not formalizing and we cannot capture a bigger share of payroll tax. That is not going to happen, so we need really shift to thinking to coverage based on different financing, which is a theme in itself. Thank you very much again. It's a pleasure to be with you.
Thank you, Michal. Then now we pass to Rachel Moussier to have this civil society perspective on how to increase coverage, particularly for informal sector workers.
Thank you, Fabio, and thank you to socialprotection.org for the opportunity to present today. I should say that I'm wearing two hats. I work for WIGO, and WIGO is also a member of the Global Coalition for Social Protection Floors, who I will also be representing here. And I just want to build on some of the points that Shara shared around bringing in the missing middle. And for us in social protection, it poses fundamental questions about how we redistribute wealth in our societies and how we express our solidarity nationally and globally. Universal or near universal cash transfers were most effective in reaching informal workers quickly. This has been said over and over and over again at this conference. And I saw this in my own country, Mauritius, where the universal social pension set at just below the minimum wage was not only protected older persons, but entire households from poverty, and is now driving up local consumption. For cash transfers to be redistributive, they need to be universal, set at an adequate level, and financed through progressive tax systems. I want to come to the point around employer and capital contributions as well, because this is really central to social insurance and also key to extending to informal workers. The International Domestic Workers Federation reports that domestic workers are responding to the pandemic with increasing demands for recognition in labor and social security codes, access to minimum wages and social insurance paid through employer contributions. And contrary to what was just said by the representative from the bank, there have been successes in this experience. We're also seeing that home workers at the end of garment supply chains are calling on global brands to recognize them as workers. Just as factory workers in the garment sector are looking to brands for contributions to their social protection, home workers are at a minimum seeking emergency relief during the pandemic. These women workers are making the direct link between their labor and global corporate profits. The extension of contributory schemes to informal workers has also been talked a lot about in this conference, and is indeed an important avenue, but one that will be difficult to achieve unless investments are also made to increase informal workers' earnings and wages. This means putting informal workers at the center of national economic recovery plans and the transition to low carbon economies. We heard of this example from the previous speaker in Indonesia. We see, for instance, that street and market traders have proved to be critical to food security in urban areas during lockdowns. And they now need access to safe and hygienic spaces to pick up their work and to continue to earn. Waste pickers are already in green jobs, but face significant decent work deficits. and prioritizing job-intensive recovery by supporting these workers is key. And I want to pick up on a point Natalia mentioned. This should also include investing in the care sector to generate new decent work opportunities for women and men, reduce women and girls' unpaid care work, opening up possibilities for education, for paid work, and support those who require care, such as older persons, people living with disabilities, and young children who have been significantly impacted by this pandemic. And with each crisis, inequalities based on gender, class, migrant status, age, and ability deepen. And with each crisis, it becomes more important to make the link between work and social protection, both for those within the labor market and also for those outside of the labor market.
There we go, me again, mute. Sorry, thank you very much, Rachel. Now we pass to Juan Miguel Villa in Colombia to tell us a little bit what the government of Colombia and what's the discussion in Colombia about the options to extend social protection coverage to those workers not currently covered.
Hello, Fabio. It's good to see you again. And also I'm very grateful to the organizers, the socialprotection.org, also with my panel mates. I don't want to rank what is like more important in the sense that I would like to talk about what has been revealed from the actions of the Colombian government amid this crisis. We are a middle income country and we have the typical social protection scheme in which social security covers former workers with all the package of the social security, contributory health, contributory pensions, risk, who covered maternity leave and all that. We have the informal workers. Informal workers are not covered by all this package, but informal workers are divided in two groups. Extreme poor, which are we're already receiving the conditional cash transfers, social pensions, and other in-kind transfers. And we have a second group of informal workers that are not necessarily poor, extreme poor. And we call locally those the sandwich population because they are not covered by the formal economy and they are not extreme poor. And in our country, we have a very strong targeting method, which is a proximate test for all the social transfers delivered by the national government. So what we have done lately at the beginning of the crisis, because there were like maybe 3 million former jobs have been lost at the peak of the crisis. And those workers are either like informal now or are unemployed. And there's been like a new program, which is the solidarity income that has been designed for this population that is not covered by social security, is not covered by social assistance. And this has been really like a novelty in our country in the sense that even our social contract for years have prevented us from giving something to this population. And for the first time ever, this, in quotations, sandwich population is receiving for the first time a transfer from the government as a social transfer, because for some reason the informal workers depend on going out to the urban streets or they are forced to work in the rural sector, but with a general lockdown, it has very difficult for them to access the market in some sense. And the problem here is that this fragmentation between social security and social assistance, we face now a sustainability problem in the sense that what we have done, or the government have done, is to create like a new finance source that covers all these actions. Because in those receiving the conditional cash transfer or the social pensions are receiving extraordinary transfers now. Now we have those uncovered receiving this solidarity income is the name that we have that we have here in Colombia for this new transfer. And we have, the government has taken money from some savings that have been accumulated from the royalties that have been since 2012 accumulated from the exploitation of natural resources. So we had before the crisis this royalty fund that were designed to address pensions for the future and also the other contingencies. But now those funds have been taken to address this situation and to transfer to deliver extraordinary social transfers, to deliver also maybe for the very first time the Colombian government is implementing an active labor market program to subsidize minimum wage workers. There are maybe 9 million workers and 2.7 are receiving this subsidy from the government. And the problem is that this fund is about 3.2 or 3.5 percentage points of the GDP. But the problem then next is going to be when the fund is completely executed with no additional sources. There's going to be like real challenge to have a real sustainability of from these actions. So in a nutshell, Fabi, what we see in Colombia is one hand, we have the adequacy of the transfer because extraordinary transfers have been delivered to this extreme poor population. On the other hand, also the coverage, because those uncovered, because they were not qualifying before because they were not poor or they were not receiving the social assistance package, the social protection, the social security package, now they are receiving a transfer. Initially, the transfer for the extraordinary transfers are also the transfer, the solidary income were designed to be implemented for 3 months, April, May, and June. And now everything is already set to go through June 2021. But financing afterwards is not already defined.
Okay, now I unmute myself. Thank you. Thank you, Jorge, again. Now we're going to pass to discuss comprehensiveness. So this question is going to be asked just for Natalia, Rachel, and Juan Miguel. So to make it short, please don't use more than 2 minutes, otherwise you won't be able to get the questions from the Slido. So Natalia, Rachel, Juan Miguel, so what does it take to better cover the diverse risks of the different populations in the future? So the crisis has shown not only the lack of coverage that we just discussed, but also some dimensions of social protection that even populations that were already covered by one or two types of programs are not covered. So what do you think should be the priority in terms of comprehensiveness in the countries you work with or in the type of group you work with? Natalia first, and then Rachel, and then Juan Miguel.
Thanks, Fabio. Asking a Latin person to speak short is always difficult, but I'll try. I think as I start in the first question, I think we are convinced that a move towards universal approaches is definitely key, while at the same time acknowledging the critical importance of also making sure that these are complemented, enhanced by very specific approaches reflected in the design implementation that can effectively address the specific characteristics of certain groups, rural areas, indigenous populations, children on the move, etc. And I think here is where the work around strengthening and enhancing government's capacity in monitor and measure child poverty, multidimensional child poverty, is so critical, because here you can really look, make the numbers visible, but also look at the specificities, where, how much, and why. And in that way, being able to channel design in a much better way. A second big priority is around the idea and the commitment to building a system and not just a flagship program or one program that can cover every single thing. No, and I think this is a long approach around thinking about a comprehensive system that is looking at the different vulnerabilities of the life cycle and changing a little bit the mindset that social protection is only the concern of one ministry, either social development of labor, but it's the concern and the financial responsibility also of other sectors, education, health, and others. I think this is also, in addition to that, looking, of course, at the life cycle as a main entry point, but I think we need to broaden that a bit more and be able to collect information that allow us to design systems that not only reflect life cycle vulnerabilities, but also the additional elements that add to risk. So livelihoods, climate change, and beyond. And I think a lot of our systems have been very effectively capturing social and economic vulnerabilities, but we still have some room for considerable improvement in maybe integrating other types of risk, like climate-related risks, conflict sensitive analyses that can better capture a much more comprehensive elements and a broader set of risks that children and families are facing, and maybe have a program that really reflects comprehensively in that perspective, not just from the social and economic side. No, and I think, of course, this is very much linked to making a very strong case, as discussed by Michal, that social protection is not just an emergency response or a bandage response, but actually a core strategy for preventing risk from becoming irreversible impacts or irreversible crises. And I think this is the important element of trying to start investing in making systems much more risk-informed and shock-responsive. And it's not just a nice way of saying it, but it's really putting much more of the focus around prevention. What is the priority? I think, and this is not a brainer, it's about the political commitment to financing and to adequate finance to make sure that we have sustainable, inclusive, shock-responsive systems that are able to really have the impact that we want to see in terms of comprehensiveness. And this is not, of course, an easy answer, because that implies putting our heads together to identify not just efficient ways of managing fiscal space, but identify new and innovative financing options to make sure that we have critical investments to really address some of the gaps that we've been discussing in the first part of this panel.
Okay, thank you, Natalia. Rachel?
Yeah, thank you. I think when we talk about comprehensiveness, part of that question is about who is sitting around the table. And what's emerging from this crisis is how governments turn to civil society, including informal workers organizations, trade unions, older persons groups, women's rights organizations, disability rights and child rights organizations and networks, to identify those in need of assistance and in many instances to support relief efforts. And this has opened up new spaces for engagement with governments on social protection. Civil society organizations have drawn on human rights and labor rights frameworks to demand meaningful representation in the past. And I'd say that this remains critically important now. This includes strengthening tripartite structures, so they include informal workers as social partners debate the extension of contributory schemes. We've seen this kind of collaboration in Togo even prior to the pandemic. Improving coordination between social insurance and social assistance structures by including civil society is also key. I like to think of just the case of an older woman who is an informal worker and a caregiver for a young child. What structures does she need at different levels of government to easily claim for and access her rights to social protection and healthcare? She cannot just be boxed into an older woman or an older person. There are so many diverse responsibilities that she holds, risks that she experiences. And at the global level, more than 200 civil society organizations have signed on to a call for a global fund for social protection in accordance with ILO Recommendation 202 on social protection floors and Convention 102. This fund is aimed at supporting low-income countries who face high levels of poverty and do not have some efficient domestic resources to finance sustainable social protection systems and require international assistance. And I think essential elements here to think about comprehensiveness must be supported by the fund include national social dialogues, legislation to ensure social protection becomes a right, and reliable allocations in the national budget. And social partners and civil society have an important role within the international governance structure of a global fund for social protection. And I think we get further along when we talk about comprehensiveness, when we expand who is sitting at the table when we're negotiating social protection policies at different levels, both at the national and international level.
Okay, thank you. We pass now to Juan Miguel.
Are you? About the comprehensiveness, look, our first concern here is the sustainability of all these actions that have been taken to address the vulnerability of the population facing this emergency. We are creating in Colombia what we locally know as a social protection floor, which is not the social protection floor what we know from the SDGs. Starting from February 2021, this is going to be a new scheme for those informal workers who have some saving capacity. So in our country, we have the social security scheme with all the package, but all that in our legislation, even in our constitution, is designed for those workers earning more than a minimum wage a month. Those earning less than a minimum wage, which are more than half of our workers, have access to nothing right now. So we are opening a new door here in Colombia in order to have like a semi-contributory social security scheme, which is a social, a subsidized social insurance that covers old age contingencies, covers also other risks, like contemporary risks. But this is it's gonna be highly flexible. If someone earns less than a minimum wage, people can contribute, can make a contribution from maybe $2 and more. There is a cap, there's a ceiling for the contributions, but they can make whatever they can contribute and start receiving a social insurance or it covers the health insurance, it covers old age income, and it covers also labor insurance for other risks. We are also trying to include maternity risks. We are trying to make a disability risk in this new floor, with this new package. And it's going to be a new way. It's going to be implemented by Colpensiones. And now we are now trying to look for all these social registries but not making people to line up in a specific place, because that's impossible right now, to receive automatically the access for this new scheme where they make contributions, not at one bank office, but any other like mobile phones or electronic money terminals in any store or local store in Colombia. And in every municipality, even in rural areas, there's always a terminal where people can contribute and start receiving this insurance. So the ideal is to have the same social security package, the ideal for everyone. But given the legislation and even our constitution, those changes cannot be structurally made right now. So we are opening this new door. So this is the way that we are also thinking of making these actions sustainable, because even though people are facing this is going to be a real crisis, they still have some income to make these minimum contributions according to their capacity. There's not going to be like a floor right now, which is the current floor for making contributions is the minimum wage. So we are trying to open this opportunity for them, Fabio.
Thank you, Juan Miguel. That's fantastic. We look forward to see what the impact in 2030 and see how much Colombia has increased the coverage of social protection. So now we pass to the last component, that's adequacy. And I would like to invite Michal and Shara to address it. So basically here we are looking how to provide transfers or adequate benefits to cover the risks that people face. So here you can elaborate a little bit on the fiscal space and the trade-offs that we have around adequacy and coverage. Michal first.
Okay, thank you very much. I'll be brief as I need to switch to another meeting. We started annual meetings today of the World Bank Group, and at 11 the meeting with Senegal delegation started, but I should be there. But the issue of adequacy is extremely important, and in fact, in the triangle, adequacy, comprehensiveness, and coverage, I think it's of equal importance. I think it is important to keep the distinction in mind between social assistance and social insurance. It is still valid regardless how social insurance is financed, which is that in the case of social assistance, our main orientation must be on ensuring that everybody gets a guaranteed basic minimum. And this minimum should be defined must be defined in the least developed countries in absolute terms. And as we move up the income ladder, the relative minimum compared to the median needs to be introduced. But here we are talking about really the relationship to the needs. And then the debate at what are the level, you know the measures which we use of poverty in the World Bank. We know other institutions use slightly different countries have their own, but the notion of guaranteed basic income is the notion which we would fully support. And in fact, as you know, we are involved in working on guaranteed basic income from the least developed countries to actually most developed, that includes work on guaranteed minimum income in Greece and Italy, which were the only EU countries not having one before the financial crisis. Now, when it comes to social insurance, then the notion of income replacement comes in. And again, we have here a very rich world and very many debates. What is the right replacement rate in the old age pension system? What's the right replacement rate in the disability system? I think that here, the notion of replacement rate, given that we are talking about risk management, is entirely appropriate. Where really the bulk of the discussion should be is the financing part. I already spoke with skepticism about payroll tax, but I think that the financing part and the affordability would determine the replacement rates. You cannot go beyond the replacement rate that could be offered by public finance in the long-term analysis. I know perfectly well that there are notions what is the adequate replacement rate, for instance, in all age pension system. And I think notions we have are pretty much they should not be debatable. I think this shifts the discussion to very much to the financing part if we want to arrive at appropriate levels. Finally, and I think it is extremely important element of the adequacy. Not only adequacy is not only about replacement rates, because it's not only about money. Adequacy is also about the quality of care. And increasingly, especially given aging societies, we have a very important expansion of needs for long-term care, aged care. Especially in this area, but also in the area of dealing with poverty, the role of social workers, the role of high-level qualified people who do proper case management is growing very, very fast. And in fact, one of the priorities for us in the World Bank, as we speak those days, is to have the open source management information system available also for African countries to manage their social safety nets. But we also do it in Europe as well, where we focus on quality case management from the beginning to the end of the case and involving much more than money, involving quality services, psychological support, and others. And from my perspective, it is also a part of the adequate package of social protection for the needy. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Michal. Did I understood right? Do you need to leave now, or are you going to stay until the final?
Unfortunately, I have to leave now. Apologies for that.
Yes. Okay, can I ask you two questions? Because there are two questions here. The most voted ones, I think both of them are for you. So if you can reply in 2 minutes.
Okay, I try.
So the first one is about Aspire, that Aspire is very important to monitor coverage. And they're asking here whether we could have a more updated data, like using digital technology or big data to track coverage more in real time. And the second question is actually about your views around universal child grants, since you said that you emphasize that everybody who needs social protection should get it, but not that social protection should cover everybody. So would you advise against universal child grants? So these are the two questions.
Thank you. So on Aspire, we are just shifting the team that will be managing Aspire with a view precisely to accelerate going digital and accelerate the coverage of both the part that relies on household surveys and the part that relies on administrative data. If your question is when, please ask me in 3 months, because we are now intensely discussing what would be our how we'll be working on Aspire. On universal child grants, so here is an interesting history. I mean, for a long time, I was arguing, and that is the case in the transition of Eastern Europe in the 90s, let's go for universal child grants. Other ways of approaching are often stigmatizing. We don't have a good targeting methodologies, and there is a correlation between poverty and the number of children. So I have been for years an advocate of universal child grants. I do think, however, that currently, when we can far better, first of all, research who is poor, who is not poor, and we can far better target properly, and not even target, make sure that the grant ends up in the hands of intended participant. I think that in the current situation, it would be inappropriate not to have an affluence test of sorts. I am not for paying child grants to rich families. Let me be very clear on that. And I think we can very easily do affluence tests those days. So in this sense, I give you an example of my country, the Poland, that introduced something like universal child grants. This universal child grants has a lot of positive effects, but there is clear body of research showing how the same, in terms of poverty alleviation among children, but there is a body of research showing how the same effect with no particular technological difficulties or stigmatization could be resulted if there was some affluence testing of that child benefit. So that's where I stand on that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Michal. Thank you for your participation, and let us know about Aspire. So now, Shara,
we'll do,
please,
we'll do.
Could you... Okay, thank you. Shara, could you address the issue of adequacy?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Shara, could you address the issue of adequacy, please?
Sorry, the issue of what?
Adequacy.
Adequacy.
So we are discussing the third dimension. So now,
So you wanted me to say something about the financing issue, right? And the fiscal deficit.
Yes.
Is that what it is? The financing deficit. Yeah, I do. I mean, too bad Michal left. I would have liked to have said a few things while he was there, but that's fine. I just want to say, I mean, this issue of financing is obviously...
For you, I stay 3 minutes more. So please, I am listening.
Okay, great. Great to have you there.
Only for you.
Okay, that's great. You know, we're good buddies, Michal, now. So I'd love you. Yeah, so I just want to say on the issue of financing, I think it's great to sort of pose this question in a panel that's about universalism. Because precisely, you know, the whole point is, and you know, people like Joachim Palme has done really good research on this, Amartya Sen has done this, you know, Tandika Mukandawere did really good work on this. The whole paradox of targeting or paradox of redistribution is that the more we target, the less able we are to really be able to reduce poverty and inequality. And the reason how you explain this paradox is there's a political economy angle to it. If you want to get taxes from everyone, including the, you know, across the board, you really need to create systems that everyone can benefit from. And the more you make it poverty targeted, the more difficult it is to get that state-society relation and that citizen buy-in into paying for a really good, adequate system of social protection that includes everyone, that's adequate, and that's comprehensive. So that's, I think, a really important angle to bring into this discussion. The only way we can say, you know, we need to target to the poor is if there's a bit of money coming from, you know, international aid, and then you want to divide that. But if you want to really have domestic resource mobilization, you cannot separate the resource mobilization from the benefit side. There has to be that tit for tat so that everyone can really pay into the system, knowing that they will also benefit from the system. That's the beauty of universalism from a financing point of view. Now, on the financing gap and on the need for resources, obviously, if we need a system that's comprehensive, universal, and adequate, that meets all of those criteria, we need to raise considerable amount of resources. And that's why when you look at OECD countries in terms of percentage of GDP, you know, it's quite large. It's 20% plus that they spend on their social protection systems. And you also need resources to address many of the problems that I know Michael worries about in terms of, you know, the fact that you don't have proper administrative systems, delivery systems are weak, we don't have good, you know, people who are staffing these systems. That also, you need resources. That's also a resource question. I mean, the fact that a lot of these social institutions within the state, whether it's the social security institutions, labor inspectors, tax authorities, have been starved of funding doesn't help in creating the kind of public sector institutions that you need, where staff are given the right incentives, career trajectories, to be able to develop a sense of mission and to manage systems and really be able to effectively deliver and be accountable to right holders. So that's another reason why we need to worry about resources. Now, on the financing gap, I think the latest figures we have, the ILO figures that my colleague Fabio Duran and Tani Muzaffar and several other colleagues in the PFACS unit have been working on, and they've come up with new figures, and I really encourage you to look at the ILO website and look at the new figures. It shows that the amount of resources required to close the global financing gap for social protection has increased by about 30% since the onset of the COVID-19 crisis. Now, that's pretty worrying, given that already we had a huge financing gap even before the crisis. And for developing countries, these estimates that they have produced show that they need to invest an additional sum that is almost 3.8% of their GDP, in addition to what they already have, in order to close the annual financing and coverage gaps in 2020. So that's pretty significant. And if you look at low-income countries, in terms of GDP, it's as big as nearly 16%. So, you know, these are really, really major numbers here. And this underlines the urgency of mobilizing resources from diverse sources. Of course, we need the contributory systems as well as tax finance systems. And in order to be able to, and also we need to worry about the equity of tax collection, not just resource mobilization per se, but how equitable it is in terms of how resources are being mobilized. You know, we need to seriously be thinking about taxing the wealthy and the politically connected. It's going to be politically difficult, but there's a lot of resources to be had there. And also challenging corporate accounts for potential transfer pricing, which again is a very big issue. And there's good work in OECD is doing, and developing countries need to have the capacity to do that. And there's resources there to be mobilized. Now, while I think domestic resource mobilization will remain the main cornerstone of national social protection systems, we obviously know from the figures I just cited that for very low-income countries, international support is going to be critical, especially in the current context where we've had a crisis with falling commodity prices, disruptions in export revenues, you know, the fact that remittances have been wiped out, et cetera, et cetera. So in this context, I think we really have to think about greater global solidarity. I think there are good lessons that have been learned from the previous crisis. European countries are spending their way out of this crisis, and you know, all the power to them. They are spending and not worrying about debt to GDP ratios, and that's what to do when your economy is in such dire straits. You need to get it going until the private sector is revived, jobs are created, and you can get, you know, the taxes and revenues that you need. But there's a real problem here in that almost nine out of 10 of the global fiscal response to the crisis has happened in advanced countries. And shockingly, for developing and lower middle income and low income countries, they only have about 3% of this global stimulus. So it's tiny what's happening. And we can be excited about the number of measures that have been taken, but in terms of the quantity of resources that's going into it, it's tiny. And this is why the latest ILO monitor referred to the stimulus situation as a huge stimulus gap, you know, between the rich countries and the rest. And for many of these countries, as I said, you know, they're facing fiscal restraints, severe fiscal restraints, including $1 trillion of scheduled external debt repayments that they have to do in this year and next year. And there are many, I think, on the positive side, many proposals out there to enable developing countries to be able to mount a much stronger counter-cyclical response. And they urgently need that from issues around debt cancellation, which rightly have been put on the agenda, to the demand for issuing more SDRs or diverting SDRs into, you know, to developing countries, and the setting up of the Global Fund for Social Protection that that Rachel referred to. These are great proposals that are out there. And let me just, Fabio, finish by saying, I think it's really also equally important that countries are not just able to spend now, but also to sustain their levels of social spending when the immediate sort of health crisis associated with the pandemic subsides, to make sure that people are protected against the kind of economic and social fallouts that are likely to persist for a longer time. We really need to resist the temptation that is already there and the push that's already there for going for another round of austerity as we emerge from this crisis. And it's really urgent to streamline the policy frameworks of all the relevant actors, particularly the international financial institutions, with the principles that are set out in international human rights instruments and social security standards. Today, we really need to think about fiscal policies so they can accommodate rather than undermine the much needed investments that we need to build universal social protection systems. So I'll just end there. And I think there's a plea out there from civil society as well. We really need to resist. We cannot have another round of austerity as we emerge from this crisis. Otherwise, we'll be even in a worse situation to confront future shocks. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Shara. So we are really short of time. I tried to ask some of the questions of the Slido. The last time I checked the voting, there was a question actually on how to use social registries to increase coverage and to improve comprehensiveness. So I would like to pass to the panelists, and you only have 1 minute to address this question and give your final message. And even if you want to address other comments that you disagree or you agree with. So let's start then with Natalia. 1 minute, Natalia.
Thanks, Fabio. And I think I alluded to some of that in my previous answer. So social registers are, I think, a critical backbone of tool that we have in order to have a better design, collect relevant information as comprehensive as possible. Really trying to see the different levels of vulnerabilities across different population groups and across the life cycle.
Sorry, Natalia, just received something here. You just have 1 minute and you need to speak slow.
Sorry, that's even more difficult.
That's trade-off.
Yes, important, critical tool, backbones for having an effective design and to make sure that we have comprehensive and adequate data. At the same time, the critical importance to link those social registries also with other information systems that are at national level, such as rural registries, data on early warning and early action programs, so we can have that very stronger comprehensiveness and be able to address a multiple set of vulnerabilities. I think that was a minute.
Sorry, Rachel.
Okay. I want to pick up on Shara's point you know, the global trends identified are indeed impressive, but they really do jar with what we hear from informal workers, including in women-dominated sectors characterized by high rates of poverty. They have received limited or no support during the pandemic, and I think that's just a reality check for us. Workers are facing a triple crisis, a health, economic, and care crisis due to the division of labor in the home and gender segregation in the labor market. And we will know we've changed the system when women informal workers and their households, who are most difficult to reach in terms of both social insurance and assistance, and with all of their intersecting vulnerabilities, are both represented at the negotiating table and receive comprehensive protection. And I just want to, my final point, take on Shara's plea around, you know, the only way that this is possible is through more progressive taxation. In my own country, we've moved in the past 3 months from a regressive flat tax to a marginally progressive income tax. So it is possible. The enforcement of employer and capital contributions, this is also happening. And importantly, which I think we don't talk enough about, is debt cancellation for low-income countries. And of course, the support for a global fund for social protection. So all indicators of solidarity within countries and also between countries. Thank you.
Thank you. Shara?
Yeah, I just want to maybe just use 1 minute to say also, you know, we're seeing whole sectors of the economy where jobs have been decimated. And some of these are never going to come back. Some of these sectors will not come back, and some of them maybe weren't that great anyway. And we have, you know, an opportunity also now to really be thinking, and I want to pick up on the point that Michal made about long-term care. You know, we have a huge care deficit. We, you know, people talking about automation and there's no jobs. I mean, there's tons of work to be done. If we think about the kind of workforces that we need to run childcare centers, long-term care institutions and delivery systems, you know, home care, whatever, but you need a workforce who is going to run that. And we need to make all the shifts that are needed to a greener economy. And for that, to shift people from one sector to another, you need a very robust social protection system to give them the possibilities of getting training and changing jobs and being able to have the kind of protection that is needed to do that. Now, and developing the care sector in particular, I think, is something that we really need to do. It is a green sector. It doesn't have, you know, it doesn't have a big carbon footprint. And it's something that we desperately need. And we need to create jobs in order to have the taxes and social security contributions to make the social security system tick. So that's also, I think, a really important plea that I want to put on the table. And I just to end, you know, I do think we do stand at a crossroads today. We can turn the COVID-19 crisis into an opportunity, as the title of this e-conference by socialprotection.org suggested. And I really want to thank socialprotection.org for creating the space for this discussion that we've seen this week, which has been amazing. So we have the chance to build those robust, comprehensive and universal social protection systems and to resist the kind of self-defeating push for austerity that's on the horizon. Or we can just stumble kind of zombie-like through this crisis and leave ourselves exposed and unprepared for future shocks that we know are going to come, whether it's from the climate crisis or whether it's from another pandemic or it's from the financial markets and other kinds of markets. So this is really a great opportunity for us to be doing those kind of investments. And I think that's the plea that's been coming out of many panels that you have had in this e-conference. And thank you very much, socialprotection.org. And thank you, Fabio.
Thank you, Shara. So Natalia, you have 30 seconds. Sorry, I disturbed you and then you end up not saying your final message.
I thought the question was on registry. Just 30 seconds on echoing, and I think we're all on the same page, because I think, and also we've been in joint panels together with Shara around the importance of really not only advocating and having an investment case that this is key and this is a moment to act, but also putting our heads together on the question of this financing gap. So one, around making sure that we're protecting and safeguarding social investments, particularly social protection, and not because it's nice, but because it's critical as a way to prevent future crisis. Two, making sure that the spending is efficient, and we know hard choices are going to be made, but we need to make sure that those hard choices have the minimum impact of the most vulnerable and poor populations, and also be bold around the new financing options, relocation, but also debt relief, and bring in the private sector into opening more spaces to really, we're asking governments to do more and better, they also need more resources. And that requires, I think, a different way of thinking around how we are allocating resources, including stimulus packages. Thank you.
Thank you, Natalia. So Juan Miguel, you have the final say on that, but there was also a question for you. So people are really curious about how you are going to identify these informal sector workers that are going to be part of the new scheme. But you have 1 minute also for your concluding remarks, and it would be good also for you to talk a little bit about the financing and about progressive taxation, as has been just raised.
About social registry, there's an example what happened here with the solidary income program that was rolled out in April, May. We had financial information, we have cell phone information, and the main ingredients here are identification and selection of those beneficiaries. So we couldn't have these massive campaigns to tell people to come over and sign and do all this paperwork to join the program. So all these databases were crossed and joined in order to filter those who were already receiving a social transfer, a conditional cash transfer or a social pension or all other in-kind transfers, and those former workers. So those were not included in those databases, were identified through the financial information and also cell phone information, and text messages were sent to these people. And the text message would say to the person, look, you are a new beneficiary. There were 2.6 million people receiving these text messages. You are the beneficiary from the Solidarity Income Program. Now you will have to go to our online web page, which is free of charge, in terms that the mobile carrier wouldn't charge you for looking at this web page. And introduce your national ID number and you will know how to claim the transfer. So it was easily and rapidly scaled up, and just by having previously all this social registry from the people receiving the social assistance, all eligible for social assistance, and also from the usual former workers from the social security. So it was a real novel a step that the Colombian government followed, in the sense that 20 years ago, when the first direct cash transfer program were implemented, there were like real massive campaigns to make people come in. Now there was only the use of administrative data to make people participate and receive this emergency transfer, Fabio.
Okay, thank you. So thank you all the panelists for this amazing session. I really like this controversy, the news from Colombia, all the innovation that's coming through from Colombia, but also the discussion we had around universality and also around how to finance the increasing coverage and comprehensiveness and adequacy of social protection. I would also like to thank Mariana Balboni, the lead heads and the brand behind the socialprotection.org, for organizing this amazing conference. Mariana, we at IPC are very proud of you, and I'm sure that all our partners, sponsors feel the same. So without much ado, I would like virtual claps for Mariana. And I think that now we'll pass to you, right, Mariana? We're going to Mariana for the final words.
I will
words.
In between Mariana and you. Thank you very much, Fabio, for moderating. We gave it more time because this is a very interesting panel. I think, and I can still see that we are more or less the same numbers as we started. So that's great. So it shows that there's a lot of interest in this topic. But thank you to all the speakers. Thank you to Fabio. And thank we you. Are coming now to the final curve of the conference. So let's start first with three short announcements. For the last time, remember we have the self-reflection. Valentina Baca highlighted it again this morning. So please, it's worth your time. You will see the link in a moment in the chat. And if you haven't done your self-reflection about what your country could have done better to respond to COVID-19, it's very, very helpful. Secondly, we invite you one more time, after all these days of interacting, learning, sharing, there is still the chance to take a commitment on our tribute. We would like to see some more faces and hear some more voices who will just take a 30 seconds or 45 second commitment. So we decided to keep it open for a little bit longer while. So if you have time today, do it today or maybe tomorrow. Please take a video and share your commitment. You can also do it on the Padlet, on our little boards. You saw a preview also from Valentina. Please, we want to see your words, how you are committed to do social protection in the future. So then I wanted to mention that the recordings will be available soon, right, for today. The other ones are available already on socialprotection.org and different channel. I think Social Protection has a YouTube channel. So check it out. If you missed something or you want to recommend, for example, the two panels today, then you can share the link. And last but not least, I wanted to showcase one more time the results or preliminary results of our graphic recorder, Sonja. She has done an excellent job. And can we see something, or at least her camera, so you see how busy she has been in the last hours to capture what you guys have all been sharing? Is there any chance to see something or focus on her work? You have seen already the results of the first day, and I think we're already sharing it in different ways, in social media especially. I don't see something coming up. Okay, so maybe we wait for a second, show it later.